Good evening and a warm welcome on the second or final day of this two-day international webinar on Reliant and Emerging India post-COVID-19, organized by Department of Commerce and IQSC, Herombo Chandra College, in collaboration with Eastern India Regional Council, Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. Following some factual and delightful speeches on the first day of this international webinar, we are looking forward for more informative discussions today also. For today's session, we have with us our two speakers, Mr. Shubhadeep Bondhopadhyay and Dr. Sharmishta Banerjee. After that, we will have a question and answer session, followed by students' debate session. At the end of our today's program, our judges will declare the results of the debate session. Feedback form will be initiated at the end of today's session. Now, I humbly request our principal, ma'am, Dr. Nobunita Chakraborty, to deliver the welcome address to our dignitaries. Thank you for being with us. Over to our principal, ma'am, Dr. Nobunita Chakraborty.
Namaskar, Shubho Shondha. Ajke Herombo Chandra College Commerce Bibhag Ayojito ebong Chartered Accountant Institute er sahajogitay je webinar du din dhore cholche সেই ওয়েবিনারে সমস্ত অধ্যাপক অধ্যাপিকাকে এবং ছাত্রছাত্রীদের আমি স্বাগত জানাই। গতকাল এই যা শুরু হয়েছিল এই ওয়েবিনার, কিন্তু গতকাল আমি একটা বিশেষ কারণে আসতে পারিনি, সেজন্য আমি দুঃখিত। আজকে আমি জানি যে কালকে খুব ফলপ্রসূ আলোচনা হয়েছে, আজকে নিশ্চয়ই আরো আলোচনা সুন্দর হবে। এবং আমি ডক্টর শর্মিষ্ঠা ব্যানার্জি এবং ডক্টর শুভদীপ বন্দ্যোপাধ্যায় দুজনকে অসংখ্য ধন্যবাদ জানাই আজকে তারা আমাদের ওয়েবিনারে আসার জন্য, যে তারা যে সময় বার করে আমাদেরকে আজ তাদের কথায় নিশ্চয়ই আমরা আরো অনেক কিছু জানতে পারব। এই যে কোভিড-19 যে অবস্থা, সে সারা বিশ্ব জুড়ে যে অদ্ভুত একটা অবস্থা তৈরি হয়েছে, সেই অবস্থাতে কিভাবে সারা বিশ্বের সঙ্গে সঙ্গে ভারতবর্ষই বা কিভাবে তারা এগিয়ে যেতে পারবে বা এগিয়ে যাচ্ছে, সেই সম্পর্কে আলোচনায় আমরা সমৃদ্ধ হব আশা করি। জানি না কোন কবে এই পোস্ট কোভিড-19 বলা হয়েছে, কিন্তু এই পোস্ট কোভিড এর অবস্থাটা কবে আসবে সেটাই সবচেয়ে বড় বোধ হয় প্রশ্ন, যে কবে আমরা এই অদ্ভুত একটা প্যান্ডামিক সিচুয়েশন থেকে কবে আমরা নিজেদেরকে মুক্ত করতে পারবো। এখন পর্যন্ত যে অবস্থার মধ্যে দিয়ে আমরা যাচ্ছি, বিশেষত ভারতবর্ষে, সেখানে তো নিত্য নৈমিত্তিক যেভাবে আমরা দেখছি যে সম্ভবত এই যে কোভিড, সে তো নিজের হাত যেটা সেটা তো বাড়িয়েই যাচ্ছে। তবু আমরা তো আশা রাখবোই এবং আমরা নিশ্চয়ই এরই মধ্যে চেষ্টা করব মানুষের জন্মই সংগ্রাম করার জন্য। সুতরাং মানুষ নিশ্চয়ই একটা সময় সংগ্রাম করে এর থেকে উত্তরণের পথ পাবে এবং আমাদের সেই চেষ্টা নিরন্তর চালিয়ে যেতে হবে। সেই পথেরই আমরা সন্ধান করবার জন্য আমরা বিভিন্ন ছোট ছোট যে ওয়েবিনার করার মাধ্যমে আমরা সেই আশাগুলো তৈরি করার চেষ্টা করছি। আশা করি আজকেও আমরা সেই সাফল্যের দিকে আরেক ধাপ এগোবো। আমি চাই যে আজকের সেমিনারও খুব সুন্দর হোক এবং এখানে ছাত্রছাত্রীরাও যেভাবে তারা নিজেরা অংশগ্রহণ করছে সেটাও সত্যি সত্যি আমাদের কাছে অত্যন্ত উৎসাহজনক। ধন্যবাদ আপনাদের সময় একটু আমি নষ্ট করলাম, অনেক ধন্যবাদ।
Now I will request Professor Aditya Dash, Faculty of Commerce, Herombo Chandra College, to introduce our first speaker, Mr. Shubhodeep Bondhopadhyay.
Okay, am I clearly audible? Is anyone can respond?
Yes, you are.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, you are.
So a very good evening to the distinguished speaker, respected teachers, and my fellow colleagues. Today we are pleased to welcome Mr. Shubhodeep Bondhopadhyay, a very special guest from the United States of America. Mr. Shubhodeep Bondhopadhyay is currently associated with the UST Global at Austin in Texas and is acting as a general manager in the genre of emerging digital technology as a retail professional. Mr. Bondhopadhyay has held many key positions such as CFO, CIO, Chief Supply Chain Officer, E-commerce Director within the industry. He is a qualified chartered accountant and has had more than 25 years of experience. He has worked with many global companies like RPG Group, Landmark Dubai, and Carrefour before joining UST Global in the year 2014. At the UST Global, he has helped many global clients with the digital transformation, making them future ready. He is now responsible for driving sales globally for all the emerging technology, especially with respect to autonomous stores, IoT, ML project, and robotics. Mr. Bondhopadhyay also plays an advisory role as an executive coach to a couple of startup organizations. Today, he will be sharing his expert opinion on overview of the changes in the retail sector and consumer behavior. I would request everyone, please join me welcoming Mr. Shubhodeep Bondhopadhyay. Mr. Bondhopadhyay, please, over to you, sir, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good afternoon, Kolkata. Thank you. Hope I'm audible to everyone.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Perfect. Thank you very much. So as I said, good afternoon, Kolkata. It's a huge honor and privilege to take part in today's session and present my views on Reliant and emerging India post-COVID. So I think we heard from the principal that when we will get out of this COVID situation is really a billion-dollar question and millions of lives at stake. So that's very important part to keep in mind when and how we will be able to emerge, not just India, globally. So I would also like to take this opportunity to thank Hiramo Chandra College Authority, technical staff, students, and everyone associated with this webinar for making this effort, spending time on a Sunday evening with me and my other fellow speakers. Hope we'll be able to share some of our views, which may be of relevance to you. So I would start by saying that it's a question of how do you see this current situation? Obviously, the world has not seen a situation like this in the last 50 years, maybe more than that. But with every crisis comes an opportunity. So how do you see that crisis and build momentum from that? That would define who we are and what we are capable as Indians. So in that context, I'm looking at this scenario, the topic for today's discussion, and not just today's discussion. This is very personal for me. I reside maybe 10,000 miles away from you, but still very much feel about India and how things can improve. And we can really become a Reliant and emerging India very soon, COVID or otherwise. So my discussion and focus today would be centered around how India can emerge Reliant and emerging post-COVID, and how we can become a global template for success. So I would focus purely from the lens of an NRI Indian who has seen India, who has worked in India, walked that path many times before, and how we can do better from this point where we are in today. However, before I start my discussion, I would like to tell all of you that my discussion is essentially segregated into two parts. I will talk about a couple of retail trends which I see globally. And based on that, a couple of suggestions, you can take it as my advice, suggestion, whichever way, a couple of things which I have observed, and I would like to share those things with you. Now, my world revolves around cauliflower, baked beans, and shampoo. I'm a grocery supermarket guy. For the last 20 years, I worked that path. So from that perspective, everything I look at it from a retail perspective, let me put it this way. Before I start, maybe a 30-second overview of the company I work for. It's EOST Global. We are headquartered in Orange County, California. We are present today in close to 37 countries, 26,000 associates. Our key ambition, key dream today is touching 3 billion lives across the globe. And we are present in some of the key software verticals like healthcare, manufacturing, engineering, technology, retail, financial services. This part, you see that I have put EOST Global logo and said that future-proofing Indian retail. This is what we strongly believe, that these set of implications, society, technology, economy, industry, and policy, all of these have implication in terms of strategic decisions. And these decisions essentially define winning strategy for a retailer. Now, these winning strategies, typically we break it into four compartments, if you wish to call it compartment: e-commerce digital ecosystem, store of the future, and that future is now, by the way, supply chain and fulfillment, engagement and retention. These are four different pillars. Next couple of slides, you will see there's a lot of text in those slides, but you don't have to focus on those things. I will call out possibly the key drivers. And obviously after this presentation, I'm going to share my presentation deck if anybody is interested to, you know, go through that in future. So in this slide, I talk about those five strong pillars, how society, technology, economy, industry, and government policy changes retail dynamics worldwide. In this slide, the key takeaway is essentially economy and policy, given the current situation we are in. So you have seen, I have seen in India and worldwide, there's an explosion of e-commerce growth. Everybody is talking about e-commerce fulfillment and creating a broader ecosystem, which will enable goods and services across multiple towns, suburbs, villages across the globe. Policy is a very important part. We have seen how policy can impact, strong impact on livelihood, and how policy can really change consumers from an analog world to a digital world. These are the scenarios which we are planning for. The topic for today's discussion was post-COVID. So from that perspective, I'm strongly focused on talking about how the post-COVID situation is changing shopper behavior, retailer reaction to the market forces, and how different brands are interacting today. So you can see that, again, proximity, speed, and convenience are essential. This is nothing new. India is all about kirana stores, mom and pop stores in every locality, pada, as we call it. From retailers' perspective, e-commerce turns to stores, very important. Stores are becoming fulfillment hub globally and in India too. And brands, from brands' perspective, go-to-market flexibility is becoming key. Many, many brands are starting their direct-to-commerce journey. And analog consumers are getting digitized, as we spoke. So more and more opportunities are coming the way of the for the brands. Here I talk about proximity, speed, and convenience. Now, in this context, again, retailers will respond to both proximity, convenience, and speed-enhancing solution. Important thing to keep in mind, these local stores, kirana stores, all of us expect them to serve us as consumer in a very safe and secured way, which is becoming very important. And even if the vaccine comes in next 2 months' time, it would still continue to be a winning formula for the small mom and pop stores and retailers across India and globe. Market positioning gets sharper. You can see that diversified product portfolio, bullet point one, and brand extension to address the needs of different ethnic and income demographics is important. Important thing to keep in mind is also bullet point four, flexible supply chain to support retailer positioning around channel availability and fulfillment. This is so critical. We have seen in every single category inside, if you go to dental care segment, you will see 40 different types of toothpaste. The question is, do we really need 40 different toothpaste in the middle of pandemic and beyond? So assortment rationalization inside store is going to emerge as a strong focus. And everything which I'm mentioning now, I will try to draw a conclusion from all of these and give some guidance on those matters, that how these things are relevant in our context. E-commerce turns to stores. This is not a news to any of you. Flexible supply chain to support accelerating and increasingly complex fulfillment options. Delivery of cauliflower is not equivalent to delivery of a textile or t-shirt material or a sofa set, for instance. It's difficult. It's expensive and time-consuming. Partnering with online platforms to drive visibility in associated independent stores to win in emerging markets. This is a very, very important point. Many brands are trying to do that, creating significant customer outreach programs to reach those consumers which they could never reach, even in the middle of pandemic. Retail, of course, you have seen that, Cartsy, Flipkart, and Amazon in India, and multiple other players. Retailers cannot exist in their own bubble. They have to create an ecosystem, and that ecosystem makes that retailer who they are. So if you look at the global template, whether it is Walmart or Amazon.com in USA or Alibaba in China and multiple other countries, it's a huge ecosystem play. Key point to keep in mind from this slide is smart manufacturing to enable niche groups targeting and personalization based on granular shopping insight. How can you activate and execute customer-focused retail execution strategy? What do I mean by that? Take the example of United States. 53 million people out of 263 million people are pre-diabetic or diabetic. 37 million people are obese. Now, if I take that number, I'm not sure about the number in India, but I'm sure pre-diabetic, diabetic, and obese category would easily add up to close to 100 million people. Now, do we have focused assortment inside that store? Do we have focused personalization, communication, execution plan around those categories? Those are going to be vital grounds to win. Data is the new oil, which people spoke for many, many years. This is very important, that how do you optimize and effectively utilize that data to drive your innovation? And we are going to talk about it. This is one of my key strong beliefs, that data is the new oil and how one can utilize that new oil to jumpstart India's growth in global software platform. Go-to-market flexibility is king. Here, the key takeout point would be the warehouse automation to support high-frequency, small-volume logistics. Now, as all of us know, typically before pandemic, I used to go to a supermarket at least 8 to 10 times in a month. Now, has that been reduced? Perhaps not. Perhaps initially a little reduced, but it has come back to the same 8 to 10 times a month. It essentially means that as a retailer, with the increasing e-commerce penetration, more and more fulfillment options are available before a customer. So as a retailer, are you able to support these increasingly complicated fulfillment options in a cost-effective way, in a sustainable way, which is very important? And warehouse automation plays a very significant role, which we are going to talk about in a minute. So I'm coming close to the conclusion in terms of post-COVID trends in retail. Digital-first approach, as you can imagine. Rise of retail tech companies, for sure. These companies, retail is all about technology today. So how strong, how powerful you are in technology and use and adaptation of technology in your context. Need for integrated inventory management. I gave the example of assortment management, for example. More than assortment management, perhaps it's the visibility of inventory in the whole supply chain is super critical and going to be very critical. Adherence to social distancing norm, safety, security of customers, my employees, super important. Contactless tick is a must post-COVID. I don't want to insert my credit card in a credit card reader and use that keypad to pay for, you know, punch my PIN code for making that payment. I know India has advanced a lot in terms of that, and it's possibly a global template in contactless retail. There's still a, you know, miles to go on that direction, especially keeping in mind that 60-70% of our population are still in rural India as well as in suburbs. Key shifts in retail landscape, this is the culmination of all the slides which I spoke about. Spending reduction in discretionary spending. Yes, surely people are not spending on perhaps on clothing and accessories today. E-commerce growth, shifts in purchasing, loyalty, switching. Footprint. Footprint is a very important aspect, which I haven't covered earlier. Right-sizing brick and mortar stores and supply chain is becoming very important. In the context of India, right-sizing perhaps is not relevant, but surely from supply chain perspective, that where do I open my distribution center? Where do I have my fulfillment center? These are very important. Safety is paramount importance. Labor dynamics. How can I use workers, you, me, everybody, my boss, everybody, in a very productive way, in an on-demand economy, in a correct way? So there are potential, you know, pathways to success in grocery, and athleisure category, apparel, footwear, leisure segments, and restaurant. And these are some of the trends which we can talk subsequently. Now, keeping all of these things in mind, these are some of my conclusion from this is not UST Global's point of view, this is purely my point of view. So you will see that I have called out two sections, planning and opportunity. Manufacturing center of scale to support global retail, e-commerce, and logistics. The first thing which I strongly believe, you have to believe. So conviction is key, according to me, in manufacturing industry. From that perspective, I have just shared in a very lighthearted note here. Banning TikTok is not the answer to create job, but producing Ganesha idols in India is. What do I mean by that? It's a personal anecdote, and let me share that over 10 seconds. Earlier, I used to stay in California. Last year, during Ganesha festival and Diwali, I went to my local Indian grocery store and stumbled upon Ganesha idols and many other idols manufactured, said, made in China. So it was a hugely frustrating moment for me that can't we produce Ganesha idols in India, which will go for for the global audience, for millions and millions of Indians who are staying abroad? Perhaps we can. So this is on the lighter side note. But the key important thing which I would like to drive in today's session, courtesy pandemic, global decision makers are looking silently for alternate sourcing option outside PRC. Don't get me wrong, I have nothing against PRC. But this is a global change which we are witnessing today. And this is a fundamental shift, and that this shift is going to continue whether you are in pharma industry or beyond. Supply chain and sourcing is going to change dramatically, and it is already changing. So my advice to my fellow students and entrepreneurs would be that don't focus so much on PRC. Your competition is Thailand and Vietnam. They are cornering today at least double the volume of FDI, which is coming to these countries compared to India. So start thinking about junior league, then we can think about going to the senior league and start talking about PRC. Can it happen in parallel? Absolutely, it can happen in parallel. Now, government has given a very key policy decision that we would like to create 100 million new jobs in this sector, make in India, Atmanirbhar Bharat. All these are absolutely right step in the right direction. Industrial corridors and smart cities can become a template. So these are from a planning perspective. Now, how does it matter from a retail business perspective? And look at the right side, second bullet. I spoke about warehouse automation. Now, warehouse automation cannot be just restricted to the retailers. Unilever, P&G, Nestle, and Johnson & Johnson, all of them have to automate dramatically their global supply chain to meet and beat the new normal, which means globally they're going to spend annually close to $300 billion in warehouse automation, material handling equipment, manufacturing processes. So I would like to seriously request everybody in this webinar that focus on this segment. There is no clear winner in warehouse automation space. There is no dominant player in this space because market so far was insignificant globally from retail perspective. This can be our trump card, truly a trump card globally to meet and beat PRC as well as multiple other Germany and multiple other countries and create our flag and raise our flag in those markets. Similarly, clean energy, electric vehicles, middle mile and last mile are becoming super crucial. Everybody is investing in clean energy. If you look at Detroit, most of the big automakers are betting billions of dollars in EV. Why can't we manufacture electric bicycle to start within India and become a global hub for EV going forward in next 3 years' time? It's not rocket science. We have the technology, we have produced cars. We were the world's largest bicycle manufacturer, for instance. So we can absolutely do it, and this is my conviction. The second topic, this is not a wish list. There is no choice. India has to become a global hub in AI, artificial intelligence. We discovered the binary system. This is known to everybody. Now, binary system was there, computer coding, all different technology languages, everything was there. But what really has changed in last 3 to 5 years is industrial design, development in semiconductor industry. We are able to put more transistors on a microprocessing ability on a chip design, which is giving exponential computational power in the hands of software development team. This really has fueled the growth in machine learning, deep learning, and computer vision. Our education system is fantastic. Is there a room for improvement? Absolutely. Upskilling and reskilling, huge opportunity globally. We have, maybe my number is wrong, maybe more than 1.7 million STEM graduates coming out every year, which is fantastic. And government is pushing for rapid digitization, inexpensive connectivity, multiple things which are happening together. So how do we translate all these things to become a global hub? And there is no choice, as I said. I strongly believe it has to happen. We need the next generation of SAP, Oracle, Salesforce in AI, artificial intelligence, need to come out of India. We need large product companies with strong focus on artificial intelligence. And this is where we are going to move the needle in manufacturing industry, agriculture, retail, healthcare. How so? In my daily job, I talk to global retailers, their chief digital officers in retail, about fresh produce quality. Now, fresh produce quality defect detection inside a warehouse is super important. And today, it is done manually. Now, why they would like to detect the defect? Because you won't buy a strawberry which has got a green patch on top of it. You won't buy a watermelon which is damaged. You won't buy a lettuce which is a little black on the edges. You are not going to buy that. So the retailer has to throw it away. So using computer vision, just one example, you can dramatically improve the current situation of food wastage in the whole chain, yet make the retail chain profitable. This is just one sliver of an example. And I can go on and on about giving you examples on this. Again, there is no clear winner today. Nobody has even scratched the surface of AI opportunity. We must become the global AI hub. And COVID, as I heard yesterday, our secretary from Institute of Chartered Accountants of India spoke in his opening speech about digital economy and how COVID has changed the global force. Anybody in across the world can, you know, interact with people and employ people in India and everywhere. So we need to move away, possibly, from non-value-added AI work to value-added AI work and take the AI supremacy clearly. The third, and this is the last piece of my discussion topic today. Next, Alibaba from India. Why not? We have done Flipkart, we have done Myntra, we have done so many different retail formats out of India. We have produced Infosys, we have produced Wipro, we have produced so many different companies. Now, why did I mention Alibaba? Earlier, you saw me taking a position saying that don't compare with PRC, talk about Vietnam and Thailand. But here, Alibaba, why not? So the point is, Alibaba emerged from China 7 years back, 7-8 years back, and today is possibly 6 times bigger than Flipkart and Amazon India put together. And Financial is global powerhouse in financial processing industry. So if you think about just Southeast Asian scenario, there is no clear winner at all. This is our opportunity to go global and put Indian flag, create the next Alibaba e-commerce engine out of India, and not necessarily selling out to a big global brand and maintain our supremacy in e-commerce. Now, why I'm focusing on e-commerce supremacy? There is a reason behind it. The reason is essentially today, if you look at United States, Amazon is the second largest employer. We will not be able to produce millions of science graduates and computer scientists and data scientists, but there are innumerable role which is required in an e-commerce setup where we can fulfill those job opportunities, give people meaningful employment. And this is becoming very important post-COVID, where people are worried about job situation today. To get that mantle of creating next Alibaba from India, my advice to my fellow students would be dream big, but focus on the execution skill. Execution is ultimately the key driver in making you successful entrepreneur. I know I'm coming close to my time limit. So in conclusion, I would say 3 things. Execution is key. Don't lose focus from that particular topic, maintain focus on that. Create a short-term, medium-term, long-term plan. Start with a 30, 60, 90-day plan that you, as an individual, what can you do to make India reliant and emerging post-COVID, as and when that happens? But should we wait for that moment for the COVID situation to get over? Possibly not. We can start planning right away in a digital economy. Take opportunity with all the available tools today. Most important, believe in yourself. Conviction is key, and you alone can make the difference and make India reliant and emerging. I will conclude by again thanking Hiramachandra College, technical staff attached with this webinar, and students, and have a wonderful week ahead, and stay safe, stay focused, stay sharp. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for shedding light on how India can become a global template for success. And definitely conviction is the key, and what we have to do to make our nation reliant and emerging, in what way we can take the help of different technologies and how we can make India a global hub, artificial intelligence hub. So thank you for shedding light on the 5 strong pillars that you have already mentioned. Now I would request Professor Shatadruti Chakraborty, Faculty of Commerce, Hiramachandra College, to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Sharmishtha Banerjee. Over to Shatadruti.
Thank you, Dr. Paramita Dutta. I, Shatadruti Chakraborty, faculty, Department of Commerce, Herembu Chandra College, now take this opportunity to introduce our next speaker for the evening, Professor Dr. Sharmishtha Banerjee. Dr. Sharmishtha Banerjee is a professor of business management at the University of Calcutta. Her teaching and research areas include human resource management, organizational behavior, and entrepreneurship. The focus of her current research is small business and social entrepreneurship. With large volume of publications and a dozen successful PhD supervision, she has received several Indian US fellowships and collaborative interdisciplinary research projects. She has been visiting faculty in various business schools of different countries. Today, she will be sharing her valuable insights on recent changes in the educational sector. Ma'am, we would love to hear from you. Professor Dr. Sharmishtha Banerjee, ma'am.
Okay, I think she has not yet joined. Yes, ma'am has joined. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you.
Welcome, ma'am.
Over to you, ma'am.
Good evening. Should I start? Should I start my presentation?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Yes,
or ma'am. Will there be an introduction or anything?
Ma'am, introduction has already been done. You can start, ma'am.
I'm sorry.
No, it's okay, ma'am. Okay, I think again we have lost connection. Just have patience. Dr. Sharmishtha Banerjee will be joining us soon.
Can my screen be seen?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Right.
So I'm sorry there was this technological thing. Even after you said you start presenting, my screen went blank. And
okay.
It was the home screen of screeners. And I am totally technologically challenged. It is COVID, which acted as a stimulus for me to go online. Before that, I was...
No, it is visible. It's absolutely visible.
Okay. I am glad to be part of this webinar being hosted by Herembu Chandra College because I belong to the City Group of Colleges, if I may use the vernacular to say Mone Prane. That is where I have studied as a student, and that is where I have taken my first class as a teacher. And if I could say anything about anything in commerce today, and that is because entirely because of my teachers in Shivna Chastri College. Though I have not taught in Herembu Chandra, but I have interacted with your principal at some occasions, and I have been immensely encouraged for my activities. So when we talk about Citigroup, I cannot begin anything unless I express my gratitude to Professor Ratan Chen, who has been not only a teacher, but a role model. Every time I enter class, I think I can never be anywhere close to him. So with that, I will share with you my little collections that I have brought forward to you in the session that we have named Education in Times of COVID. And I like to look beyond because we are strapped here for so many months. And I definitely think there is so much in education, so much in life, beyond COVID. So if you could tell me how much time I should take.
Ma'am, you have 30 minutes.
Right, thanks. So given that we, when we talk of education, we cannot ignore the fact that we are at this junction where it is important for us to understand that traditionally India has grown from the Gurukul system, where not only learning hours, but in the entire life was education. And the life of the student was totally intermingled with the life of the guru, the teacher. And that is how education was perceived in the original Indian education system. Then we went into the traditional university system, wherein there was a classroom and there was one teacher. And this classroom concept brought in many students and teachers. So there was this peer interface as well as the teacher interface. So there were two levels of interface. If we may use the words of management today, I would say there was vertical as well as horizontal integration in terms of knowledge exchange. Then in the 1980s, it was felt that the country is developing and education is so essential. And then came the concept of distance learning. Distance learning came about, but with the introduction of Indira Gandhi National Open University. And the idea was to connect part-time learners with part-time teachers. The idea was to bring back to the formal education system the ones who had dropped out in midway through their education process. The idea was to create a parallel learning experience. An engineering student could take up a fine arts course through the Indira Gandhi National Open University. And then, of course, came the Netaji Subhash Open University. But these were all distance learning modes, and these were not the version of digital and online platforms that we are facing today, that we are bound to face today. So what I definitely want to mention to you, that when we started distance learning, the idea was to go inclusive. And when we go digital, the idea is the challenge is we cannot go inclusive. So distance learning and digital learning are the two platforms that we often are facing now. But what was the challenge in distance learning is that Indian society brought about a lot of status and hierarchical difference in terms of Indira Gandhi Open National University. And I'll give you an example. If you do MBA from Calcutta University, you can start doing your PhD. But if you do MBA from IGNU, then you have to get a special permission, a recognition, an equivalence to do your PhD from any university. So this hierarchical difference in academia was created. Therefore, I wish to remind ourselves as well as my audience that India did not accept distance learning mode to be on the same platform as university or classroom learning mode. And given this situation, we are now in a paradigm where we are on the continuum of online and in-class situations. The online, which is the more commonly used terminology, is basically a way of digital learning. And by digital learning, through the platforms that we are using, we find that the online instructions are much more prepared, structured, have much lesser flexibility, and therefore are totally unable to establish a teacher-student relationship as they may exist in a classroom situation. Though we cannot say that it has all demerits, we can say that various students who could not otherwise have access to talks by different faculty, by international faculty, different timings, phasing out learning, all that can be possible or is made possible through the online different digital platforms. Whereas in-class learning is when the teacher-student relationship is much more closer. And as I mentioned, there is an aspect of horizontal learning also, peer learning. There is flexibility as to what the student is understanding, what the teacher is understanding, and this is the juncture where got us to. So this is where I will take a moment out of the PowerPoint and see how many participants are there in today's webinar. If I may ask the organizers to give me an idea, how do I know that? How many participants are there? Do we get to know this? Is there any way we have a possibility of talking to the audience, to the organizers? Because I want to post a question where I want organizers to answer.
Madam, please open your PPT.
My PPT is open.
Yes, it is. Minimize the screen and open. Yes, yes, yes.
No. I posted a question on the chat box. Because I want my audience to answer a question that I will post before them. Is that not possible?
Yes, you can open a blank PPT screen, then there you can type your question.
But no, but not the chat box. I posted a question in the chat box.
This chat box is private chat box.
I went into the comment section. I went to the comment section.
You can go to the comment section.
Went to the comment section.
Yeah.
Yes, and how I want to post a question. Can I post a question?
At the bottom, there is an option to post your question. At the bottom, post your message.
Post message, Pachina. Comments. I can't find the post message. Well, not possible then. New comments. No question is there still now. Well, then I should not do it, I believe. Then I should not do it. All right. My question was, among the students, I would have asked, what percentage of your mind is happy with the online class? That was my question. So each individual would have a unique answer. What percentage of your mind is satisfied with the online classes that are going on? Well, if that's not possible, I will go ahead. And I want to bring to you that I have prepared we have come to the same platform where we have known how the Indian education system has evolved, and the system of open universities did bring about distance learning. But the distance learning is different from the digital learning that we are doing. So that brings me to the situation is, in this backdrop, I have got a visitor who was not invited. So here we have the COVID virus. And how has COVID affected us? The preliminary thing, how has COVID affected education? Why has education been affected? Because to bring about a stop in COVID, because to mitigate the effect of COVID, what we need to do is social distancing. So social distancing is what has impacted education. COVID has brought about the need for the mandatory need for social distancing, and social distancing has affected education. So when COVID interrupted our lives between 15th and 20th March, schools, colleges closed overnight. Faculty and administration were at their wits' end to design something so that the system could be kept going. So here came in the names that we were not familiar with. We did not know about WebEx and StreamYards and Google Meet and MS Team. We did not know these names. Mobiles were a no-no in schools. And in colleges, mobiles had to be kept on vibration mode inside bags. And now they were the most essential. And they were replacing chalks and dusters and blackboards and whiteboards of all purposes. So here we find social distancing has become such an important term that it has found a place in the dictionary. There were three words added to the Merriam-Webster dictionary in 2020, and social distancing was one among them. So originally, the word social distancing can be traced to a medicine, and which meant proxemics, that is distancing from each other in everyday life. Under ordinary circumstances, the interpersonal distance chosen by two people varies between mother and child, varies between couples, varies in professional situations, varies in different professions and countries and social setups. So social distancing is what has affected our education system, because it is because of the inability of our education system to ensure the required social distance that we have closed the classrooms. Now, this brings me to the idea of the usage of social distancing. The concept of social distancing was referred to as an action of avoiding people. That was a conscious action of avoiding people, socially as well as emotionally, rather than physically. That is how it was talked about in sociology. But now it is repurposed to mean physical distancing. We're trying to physical distance ourselves, which goes by the common terminology of social distancing. I must tell you something very funny. When social distancing was in practice due to the Spanish flu, we could see women and men, of course, even their pets had masks. And historically in Europe, it was found that it was only the very rich who could wear gowns, which prevented others from coming close. So this also not only prevented social relationships, but also prevented contamination. And this finally became a kind of etiquette. So these huge skirts were so big that you needed another person to put it on for you, and you needed a big enough house to wear it and walk around. So that was called social distancing fashion. Well, if we go back to school today, we will have social distancing fashion undoubtedly, because all of us have equipped ourselves with different kinds of masks. Well, that takes me to the more sociocultural aspect of India, where social distancing was there even in the caste hierarchies. And there were public resources which were totally different. Like, we know of situations where the lower caste went to a different pond, went to a different school, were not allowed in a temple. Even their crematoriums were different. So social distancing is not something that we did not know about. It's just that we did not practice them in our classrooms. But then what is the social distancing which is affecting our lives, our education system in such a way? I will bring to you a research story. You know, I am a professor and I love to look at research when I do something. This is a very, very funny research, I must say. That this one was done by Soro Kowalska, and it covered almost 9,000 people from 42 countries. And there were three different kinds of relationships that were studied: public, social, personal, and intimate. When we spoke about public, social, personal, and intimate, we found that people were asked questions. What distance do you maintain with another person in public places, in social places, and in personal and intimate places? So every respondent in the survey was given the scale and asked, what distance do you keep with another stranger in social interactions? What distance do you keep with another acquaintance in personal interactions? What distance do you keep with a close person in intimate relationships? This scale was given, this mobile scale, and every respondent could move this and show the distance. As I mentioned, there were 9,000 respondents and they were people from 42 countries. So the answer was obtained in centimeters, and in Saudi, I have specifically brought in three countries, which were three culturally different paradigms. And we find that in Saudi Arabia, the distance that people maintain between two individuals is wide. In Argentina, they have a very hugging, close culture, so it was very close. And in India, the social distance that a person prefers to keep between two strangers is 110 centimeters, which is about less than 2 meters. And how much is the allowable distance? It is to 6 feet or 2 meters. So here we find that we are not at all comfortable with what the allowed interpersonal distance is between these. So as I mentioned to you, that physical distance is what we are trying to talk about, and the terminology that we use is social distance. Physical distance has been replaced by WHO, though the common terminology continues to stay as physical distance. There is an impact, as we will just now go to talk about the impact of social distancing. Impact of social distancing impacts education, but I will tell you how it has affected the lives of people in the history of disease-related isolation. This study was done by Brooks, and this study compared the earlier studies done by Taylor in 2018 and by Wu in 2008 and 2009. This study in Australia showed that there were 22,760 quarantined people versus non-quarantined people. And 34% of the quarantined people, in comparison, 12% of the non-quarantined people had high levels of anxiety. So when you are quarantined, there is chances that you have high levels of anxiety. Another study which was done following the SARS outbreak, which was done over 549 hospital workers who had 50% of them who were quarantined. It was found that after 3 years, the 50% of the quarantine sample had high level of alcohol abuse. So we try to share with you here that quarantined individuals, whether in the short term or in the long term, have impacts on mental health. So this takes me to the effect of quarantine, to the effects of social distancing, which Corona has brought about on different fields of our life. And hereafter, I will focus on the issue of education. We find that the social distancing has affected entertainment. It has affected office, workplace, professional workplace, and it has affected educational institutions. The primary effect has come in the form of loneliness, fear, anxiety, boredom, irritation, frustration. It has affected entertainment as well as office, and most importantly, educational institutions. When social distancing has affected in education, I will just present to you the global situation. The global situation, we find that there are three major impacts that have come about. This World Bank study says that there has been a fall in the average learning level of all students. by average learning levels of all students, we find that the students who are not attending classrooms, the classrooms are empty, and we find that the learning levels are falling because they are trying to learn from their homes. We will talk very soon at the challenges of learning from their homes. We find that also, in addition to this fall in the average learning levels, we also find that there is a widening of the learning achievements due to unequal effects of the different kinds of population. The learning achievements of one sector of the student population is much different from the learning of the other section of the student population. On the third level, we find that there is a possibility of an increase in low level of achievement due to massive dropouts. These are the three things that is happening at the macro level. I'm quoting this from a World Bank study, and we will go into now an understanding about how it is affecting our day-to-day lives. So if we talk about the Indian situation, who is affected? It is important for us to understand that 158 lakh girls and 162 lakh boys have been affected countrywide, from primary to middle school to high school, as well as to tertiary education. And it is very unfortunate that the highest level is in the secondary education, where these people have crossed many hurdles to cross the pre-primary and primary education. So this large chunk of 133 lakh students are affected by this divide of that has brought about because of COVID, because exercise books are being replaced by tablets. Children playing together are being replaced by the mad rush for the Wi-Fi connection. So what are the main challenges that we find? The challenges that I find are in terms of economic, which have their impact on digital, the urban, rural, as well as the gender divide. We know there are underprivileged students, both in the urban and the rural areas, who do not have access to smartphones, to computers. We also know that even if they have access to smartphones and computers and tablets, network connectivity in remote areas is really very poor. Even the most bright student is unable to have the desired internet connectivity. This becomes worse in this intersectionality of gender, location, and digital facility, where the girl child's education opportunities are sacrificed first. So this major challenge in this technology-driven education system is to find out how to bring about the engagement or in an inclusive manner. Thus, I go over to this current situation of how much public spending has India made in terms of its GDP. This figure may be a little low to you, but if we compare India, China, Russia, Brazil, and South Africa, we find that India has been lowest in terms of public education spending as a percentage of its GDP. It was only 2.6% in 2007 and has moved up to 2.9% in 2016. So to consider that the public spending in education by India as a portion of its GDP is less than 3% now. And where has the effect taken place? The effect has taken place, whereas only 66% of the rural population have internet connectivity, whereas the 34% have internet connectivity. Now, that brings us to an understanding: is internet connectivity enough? There is something more basic that is required, that is electricity. We find that only 47% of households all over India have electricity for more than 12 hours. 4% have no electricity, 11% have 5 hours electricity a day. So we talk of internet connection, we talk of smartphones, but what about electricity? So this is the situation that COVID has brought to the forefront. This is not the end. There are socio-psycho challenges where children are in school, even if whether they have electricity, whether they have internet connection, whether they have smartphones, the parents have to guide their learning process. And the parents may not have the adequate skill in terms of education and resources. We find there are many parents who have to go to work and the children are left all by themselves. And they are subject to a lot of stress and abuse. We find that as a result of this, there is a possibility of increased violence and exploitation. And what is basically missing is the social activity, is the human interaction, which is essential to learning and development. There are challenges to education per se. As I mentioned, the possibilities of dropout, because with the challenges in economy, the students who are at home are made to join the workforce. And as a result, their going back to school becomes the worst challenge. In addition, there are two more situations that I would like to bring to you. One is the measurement and validation of education. The stakes of assessment are very high because we know we are facing in day to day in all colleges and universities. We have had three assessment patterns in the last 2 months. The first one, we said 80% from previous semesters. The second one, we said 24 hours of assessment time. And the third one, we now say it is 2 hours, 3 hours of assessment time. So we find that this disarray of assessment is taking place. Finally, what is also happening is the methodological challenges. Those students who were moving from high school to college, those students who were moving from college to university, those students who were moving from colleges to jobs, they are found to have been disrupted in a major way. So we find that it is not only a technological challenge, it is a psychosocial challenge which has affected education per se. How does this affect society? The costs and economy are very high. Parents who may miss work, they cannot take care of the children because the wage loss is bringing about a negative impact on the total country. We know India's GDP has fallen to 23% fall in India's GDP. Another very important sector of the population which has fallen are the healthcare sector workers. What about the children of the healthcare sector workers? We find that these children are the most sufferers. I think I have 2 minutes more and I will go over to two more small things. So what is happening is there is demand-driven technology. And what are the challenges that are coming about? The challenges that are coming about is education and technology is meeting up to bring about vernacular language-based learning opportunities. So these challenges are leading to opportunities. And sometimes these vernacular-based educational opportunities are being clubbed with entertainment. And we therefore find that it is important for us to realize that how these challenges can be converted to opportunities. There is a silver lining to these dark clouds, and the positive externality that has come about is that this digital disruption has brought about a destruction in the traditional exam system. So that what is question may have been modified now to bring about a different kind of assessment system. So it is up to us, the teaching community, the learning community, the student-teacher exchanges, to make the best use of the silver lining that this dark cloud is bringing before us. The government has brought about some moves to support, but that is what the students are saying. Social participation matters to me. this is what every student I meet says. We're not interested in knowing how much we learn. This is what everyone says. Social participation is important to me. So I'm alone, but I don't want to be lonely. So what can I do? What can my alone time offer me? So there are a few things that I want to discuss with you, that when I'm alone, there is this opportunity of experiencing all that has happened, the highs and lows. And these are ways of getting emotionally connected to people whom I do care about, but I was not regularly in touch with. Old friends whom I do not connect with. Neighbors and acquaintances who I know are there, but I do not talk to them all the time. So this is an opportunity when I can be alone, but I do not have to be lonely. So what are the happy alternatives? I can teach myself on life skills. I can develop my emotional intelligence and empathy, take happiness classes, do leisure activities, things that I love to do in school, things that I thought I would do when I had a lot of free time. So there are so many life skills that I would love to make use of now. So instead of running after technology, instead of worrying and fretting over that online class that I missed because I had low bandwidth, we definitely have many alternatives. And I think the future of education lies in these tree of life skills, because technology is a very, very small leaf in this future of life skills, because there is so much more to life than increasing speed. So with this, I am open to questions. If my audience poses any question.
Thank you, ma'am, for enlightening us with your informative speech on education in times of COVID and beyond, distance learning, digital learning, social distancing. It was really nice to hear you after such a long time.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now we will start with our question and answer session.
Please.
And the moderator of this session is our Professor Aditya Dash and Professor Ishika Ghosh, Faculty of Commerce, Herombochandra College.
Hello, Ishika.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello, Aditya. You are all very junior to me, so I can call you by your first names.
Surely.
Please, ready for your questions.
Okay.
Two questions for Mr. Shubhadeep Bandyopadhyay.
Yes, can we have Mr. Shubhadeep Bandyopadhyay also? Okay, can we start with Dr. Sharmishta Banerjee? Ishika, do you have any question for her?
Yes, ma'am, I have questions. The first question is from Mrs. Shatadruti Chakraborty. She's also a faculty member of Herombochandra College. And her question is, students are returning back to traditional and passive learning mode, like only note-taking and listening rather than active participation. What measures can we take to make classes more interactive?
Measure, I cannot go in for a measure because we have not evolved much of policy prescriptions per se. But as a teacher, I would say there are different ways we could get our students involved, because like if I had this opportunity, I would ask something on the chat box and the students would respond. So this is how we try to keep the student engagement, because you know it is very sad, unfortunate and terrible for us when we realize that we cannot see our students' faces and we cannot see their eyes, which I think is my report card. Every day when I'm teaching in class, the eyes of my student is my score sheet. We know from their faces, we know from their smiles and their vision how much they have understood. And I can grade myself on that. So I definitely think that it is up to the teacher to design ways to get the student involved. Like the question that I had thought I would give to the audience, what percentage in your mind are you happy with the online class? That is one. The other question that I'm placing before you all just now, if we had 13 months in 2020, what would you name it? Go ahead. I don't want the answers now. It can come up in the chat box because we are not happy with the 12 months. We are not happy with the months April, May, June, July, August, September. And so we have another month. Now, by the grace of nature, we have been given the 13th month for 2020. What would you name it? I have a question here. Should I answer or... should I answer or will you place it before me?
Yes, ma'am.
This question is from Onuron Guho and he asks, Shormishta madam, he seems to know me. What do you think about the new education policy which prioritizes online digital learning in schools and colleges? And how will it affect future students and teachers? If you think, what do I think? I think online digital learning can only be an add-on and definitely not instead of classroom teaching. How will it affect future students and teachers? I will stop being a teacher if I don't get my students in class. Okay. Yeah, I have a name. Atul Singh has a name for the 13th month, end of negativity. The other is Bless Me Soul Month. We will get new names, I'm sure. We'll get new names for the 13th month because we want one good month for this year. Right. Next question, if any. I think my co-speaker, yes, Shubho, has joined. So,
ma'am, we have another question for you.
Yes, please.
It's from Mr. Bisham Uddhal. In this era, teacher community below middle line is not pretty for students. What should we do with him?
I think what he means is that primary school teachers do not connect with students, if that is what he means. Because our student-teacher ratios are very high in primary and pre-primary government schools. So that may be the challenge, in what little I understand from the question. If Ishika, Paromita, or Aditya, you want to elaborate on the question or go to the next?
Ma'am, we'll go to the next one. It's from Mr. Kostop Chatterjee. Due to this COVID situation, we are not communicating with as many people we used to do. Will it affect anyone's communication skill?
I think it has affected our communication skills because at other times, you know, I get pretty nervous nowadays whether I'll be able to speak in English for half an hour. Because at other times, I am taking classes, talking to students in English, and ekhon mone hoy bapre sara din to ingreji boli di. So yes, communication is something that grows with experience, that grows with practice. We become more effective and efficient speakers as we do. Therefore, when we talk about not being in class, when we talk about ensuring physical distance, we always encourage students, teachers, everybody to talk to each other as much as we can. So I often tell my students to have group meetings for no reason. So I just had my PhD students meet. That was called a no reason meet because we didn't have an agenda. So let us meet for no reason. And because we are meeting on Zoom, so that gives me an opportunity to dress up, comb my hair nicely, talk in English, talk about things that I'm not talking to family with. Talk about our professional challenges, our home challenges. It helps. It always helps to communicate with another group of stakeholders in your life.
Thank you very much, ma'am. I'll hand over to Aditya now.
And Sharmishta, one more thing to add, you were asking a question to the audience and the answers were coming in the YouTube chat box that some are saying that it is 50% there, 60% or 80% even satisfied on the, in the online classes.
So actually,
so
my idea
answers
is,
were coming.
My idea is I collect those responses and I summarize them on that slide. Social distancing matters to me. I said that because most people say that they don't enjoy much. So the summary of all that comes in that slide. So that is how I engage my participants. Thank you, Sharmishta.
Should I proceed?
Yes, yes, Aditya.
My co-speaker is possibly in a different country.
Yeah, he's from USA, Texas. Yes,
because that door is
Subhadip Bandyopadhyay.
That door is a US door, so that's what I thought.
Yes, it is.
Shubhadip Bandyopadhyay, namaskar.
Hi, namaskar.
And she is Professor Sharmishta Banerjee from Calcutta University, Shubhadip.
Hello.
And Sharmishta Dasgupta is my student. I'm so proud.
Of course.
Aditya, we can continue with the questions.
Sure. Two questions for you, Mr. Shubhadip Bandyopadhyay, sir. One is from Ankur Chakraborty. He states, we do have the technology, but we don't have proper infrastructure to back up the after-sale service of EV automobiles. We require exponential charging stations as big as petrol pumps to get it going, and he assumes that it's not going to happen in the next 3-4 years. So please share your valuable suggestions, sir, for Ankur Chakraborty.
Can we see the question on the screen, Dr. Salam, so it will be easier? Yeah.
Yeah. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. I read this question. It came a little a while ago. So I would answer it in this way, that not happening in next 3-4 years for sure. So when I mentioned EV automobile technology, not necessarily I was focusing that you are talking about infrastructure in India. If you recall in my slide, I clearly called out warehouse automation, material handling automation, and EV as two big emerging technology which can drive employment, job opportunity, and most importantly, creating intellectual capital, IP, for India and Indian entrepreneurs. So from that perspective, the target audience, target market, in short term, could be very well countries in Western Europe, countries like United States, Japan, Singapore, Hong Kong. So in these markets, maturity level of EV charging stations, technologies, these adoption rates are going up dramatically. Is it optimum? No way. Can it go up? Will it go away? Will it go up? Absolutely. Governments are spending millions of dollars. Private entrepreneurs are creating innovative business model around EV charging stations. So surely you will see rapid adoption of EV technology in Western Europe. And we as a country, we can take advantage of producing EV technology, multiple components, not necessarily the finished EV, and multiple components of that, and take advantage of that. In an Indian context, I may not be the right person to comment on whether in next 3-4 years' time, infrastructure would be sufficient to handle the growth of EV technology. I would put it that way.
So we can say, sir, we are in a process.
You can say that for sure.
Oh, okay. So, sir, next question for you is from Nobunendu Bonik. He is asking whether the traditional business are affected by e-commerce. If they are affected, then how are they going to tackle these problems?
Yes, traditional businesses are absolutely affected, whether they're in education sector or any possible sector, manufacturing, services sector. Now, when you say traditional businesses, I would imagine that you are talking about non-digital, non-organized, non-chain operations, a small manufacturing facility making, let's say, some furniture. I'm giving an extreme example, furniture, or somebody is making, putting up, you know, some electrical equipments. So these are all traditional businesses. Now, traditional businesses to adopt in adapting this post-COVID situation, they're deeply impacted. So what is required as a step one is educating more and more people in using digital tools. I myself struggled a bit in joining this platform, for instance. So if people have to join, a traditional business entrepreneur have to join a Zoom or a team or similar platform and talk to the global audience about his product and platform, they need to understand that what digital platforms is all about. So training them, educating them about digital platform, telling them about the ecosystem, which I spoke, how can they take advantage of digital ecosystem? All these things are very important to ensure that traditional businesses are not marginalized in this digital economy. Rather, they're actively taking part and taking advantage of the tools and technology which is available today.
Okay, so sir, the theory of Charles Darwin will be applicable here in this case. If they will go through that process, they will survive, otherwise not.
Yes, absolutely yes. But having said so, I read a very interesting article yesterday. So Trevor Noah commented on this particular topic, which he just said. He said that the opposite of success is not failure. Opposite of winner need not be always the loser. So the point is, as a traditional business, your failure in that particular space does not essentially mean that you will be wiped out. You will be able to, possibly, if you strive hard enough, you will be able to emerge in another way in the digital economy. So I would put it that way. Charles Darwin's theory is definitely important to keep in mind. So essentially, I come back to my same point. Conviction is key. You have to have that belief in you that you will adapt and you will come winner. Okay. So that's a strong message from my side, I would say.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir and ma'am, for your suggestions. Thank you.
So we have done with the question answers, and on the behalf of the college, college authorities, students and teachers, we thank both of you, ma'am and sir, for your great presentations, and we will expect both of you in future also to join in our seminars or webinars, whatever form we are able to conduct these seminars. Sure.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. My pleasure. Okay, so we are moving on to our next session. That is the students' debate session. So we are having two judges with us, Dr. Lily Law and Dr. Joyanto Ghosh, for the student debate session. Dr. Lily Law is currently an associate professor in the Department of English and a former HOD, Herombochandro College. And we are having with us Dr. Joyanto Ghosh, who is currently an associate professor in the Department of Commerce, Herombochandro College. So very soon we will start with our students' debate session. The moderator of students' debate session is Professor Nirupam Dash, Faculty of Commerce, Herombochandra College.
Thank you, madam. So it was a very good evening, and we have such a lovely audience, very attentive audience. So now we are moving to our next session, that is the debate session. So today our topic of debate is impact of social media on teenagers and college students. Today we'll have four participants with us for the debate session. Two participants will speak for the positive sides, and two participants will speak for the negative sides. Now, I'd like to call upon our first participant, Ms. Shayantani Mandol. Shayantani Mandol will speak for the positive aspect. Shayantani, is over to you. Please give us some time. I think there may be some network issues. Can we have our first participant, please? Can we have the participant?
Can we have the participants for today's program?
What is happening? Nothing is audible.
Sir, can you? Sir, is it audible?
Amar kotha shona jacche. No, it is not audible.
The
Lily, can you listen? I think debate is going on.
International Monetary Fund.
Sir, I think there may be some network issues. So very soon we'll have our next participant, sir. 1930s.
We borrowed the model lockdown, the lockdown model from European countries without considering the ground level reality of Indian economy. Within days of lockdown, the migrant issue was looming large. We let them suffer without food, shelter and job for 2 months. Finally, government gave up and migrant workers, the majority of whom were infected, streamed out of urban red zones of the country and carried the infection into the green rural zones. Hundreds of them have died in their way, and most of them was the only earning member of their families. Thus, the health crisis predictably lead to the economic crisis. The sudden stopping down of all the production and distribution lead to a total collapse of the economy, rendering millions jobless. About 93 million
I think this is yesterday's recording that has been played in the screen. I think we are having some network issues. We are not having today's participant And this was yesterday's program that was wrongly being played. Can we have our first participant?
We are having some technical issues. Please give us some time. Please be with us. We are having some technical issues. We'll be back to you very soon. Kindly have patience. Please bear with us. We are having some network issues.
Shortly, we will be starting with our students' debate session. And we are really sorry because for some network issues, we could not start with our debate session. So we are a little late. Please bear with us. Shortly, we will start with this, with our debate session.
Thank you, sir. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less.
Can we have Dr. Jayanta Ghosh also?
The difference, the road not taken by Robert Frost. In a world full of people talking about negative impacts of social media, taking a stand to talk about the positive aspects is really no less than taking a road less traveled by, and I'm really looking forward to make a difference. Good evening, esteemed speakers and judges, respected principal, professors and faculty members, my fellow participants and friends. I, Swayanthini Mondol from Herembuchandra College, Department of Commerce, would like to light my views in favor of the motion, Impact of Social Media on Teenagers and College Students. Remember the time when we had to write essays in school about the topic, Science Boon or Bane? From that very age, we are well aware of the fact that science has both positive and negative impacts, and it all depends on the usage. Being a brainchild of science, social media is also a double-edged weapon of the modern world. The physical world is very much similar to the virtual world in many ways. It's about being aware. Social media is one of the greatest platforms we have today, but sadly, a majority of us are unaware of its powers. The power of social media is probably greater than any individual, any community, or any country. Social media plays a very important role in a youth's life. I believe that considering social media to be a bane rather than a boon is nothing short of a travesty of justice. In order to further extrapolate on my beliefs, I'd like to present a few points in front of you. Number one, being a global platform, social media keeps us updated about all the events taking place in the world. Almost 70% of the youth receive digital news from the social medias rather than turning on the news channels or reading newspapers. Social media even comes up with such news which news channels are even unaware of. Social media provides an opportunity to publicly showcase the creative side of a person, encourages them to continue with their wonderful works, which may even give rise to young entrepreneurs and also provide the platform to carry on small businesses and social media marketing. Last and the most important one, I believe that youth empowerment in the digital age, using digital media for amplifying voice, giving rise to fresh perspectives, developing strong personal opinions, youths are leveraging social media to affect social impact. Just a gentle reminder to everyone present here, it's us who has misused and maligned social media platforms. Social media itself can be abused, overused, or even taken advantage of. It's high time for us to accept that we are the one to be blamed and not social media. Rather, social media should be considered as something which has the power to alter the very course of human history as we know it for the better. I'd like to conclude by asking, are we as a society, ladies and gentlemen, are we as a society seriously delusional enough to shut the door on opportunity when it's knocking at our very doorstep? I rest my case. Thank you.
Well executed performance by Shantani. Thank you. Now we will have our next participant who will speak for the negative side. I'd like to call upon Soumya Menon. Soumya, is over to you.
Sir, am I audible and visible?
Yes, you are audible.
Thank you. Good evening to the honorable judges, respected principals, respected professors, all the faculty members, to all the esteemed participants and speakers, to all my fellow friends, and of course, to the lovely audience. First of all, I would like to thank my professors for giving me such a wonderful opportunity. I'm Soumya Menon from Heramachandra College, Department of Commerce. And today's my topic is impact of social media on teenagers and college students. And I will be speaking against the motion of the topic. Before I start, I would like to say, I'm most certainly not against of social media. I agree with the beneficial part of it, which was highlighted by my friend Shayantani. But we all know that there are two sides in a coin. Similarly, social media has a dark side too. Firstly, as a teenager or as a youth, we constantly feel the need to show our highlight reels to massive amount of people. Now the question is, what is highlight reel? Highlight reel are the collection of our best and brightest moments of our life. And the sharing of our highlight reel is not a big deal. But the problem arises when we struggle with insecurities that because we start comparing our behind the scenes with everyone else's highlight reel. It used to happen before, but it was quite often. But after the introduction of social media, it is happening frequently. Secondly, on the basis of social currency, we are valuing ourselves. And the currencies are like something which we used to value goods and services. And but in social media, these social currencies are the likes, the shares, the views, and the subscription which we are getting on our social media platform. In marketing, we have a term called economy of attention, and in which everything is competing for grabbing our attention. And when we give something like, or when we give that a piece of finite attention, it becomes a recorded transaction attributing value, which is great when we are selling clothing or something like that. But the problem is, in social media, we are the product and we are letting others to value ourselves. And depending upon those values, we are changing our sense of identity, which is not good. Thirdly comes the FOMO, fear of missing out. Fear of missing out, we are more and more dependent on instant gratification to be feel included. We are forced to post, gram, upload, snap, chat, message, or react. It creates a feeling of anxiety within ourselves. And we think that we are missing any potential event or opportunity. Fourthly, the platform like Facebook and Instagram are giving young people distorted images that how their body should look by being constantly presented with highly idealized view about appear. It elicits the feeling of envy and feeling of inadequacy. Social media is not evil, but it is very well be dishonest views that are unrealistic, but the reality which is unreliable, and the world which is filtered and altered for the benefit of a person or a group, and which is the very essence of corruption. Social media is not limited to these four problems only. Online harassment, trolling, cyberbullying, and of course our physical health is also being affected by social media. In American Journal of Public Health has stated in their report that more than 3 million students are finding with high symptoms of depression and stress. And more than one, the worst part of it is that more than 1 million of these students are attempting suicide by getting depressed due to this excessive use of social media. The active demographic of social media varies between the age group of 14 to 26. And we are spending more than 2 hours a day in social media platform. Even we don't eat for so much long time. And when we are doing anything for so long time, it has a lasting effect on us. Nowadays, our real life relationship is being replaced by digital relationships. We are spending more time of our life in living in digital world. We prefer online interaction rather than organic interactions. So my message is to you guys that for our own mental peace, can't we stop this swiping, stalking, and chatting and start talking? We all know that we can learn from a person by seeing in the eyes of that person, not from the social media profile of that person. I want to conclude by saying that although I agree that social media is a great platform for grabbing opportunity and it has been proved great in this pandemic situation, but at the same time, social media due to associated with social media, alarming problems are also knocking at our door. So my question is to the audience is that, should we avoid this question and move on? Or should we wait for a while and just look into the matter for once? Secondly, should we use the social media platform and make the social media platform as an inseparable part of our life? Or should we use it as a tool for benefiting our life? I rest my case. Thank you.
Well, I'll get back. Thank you, Soumya. Now I'd like to introduce our third participant who will speak for the positive side. I'd like to call upon Nilanjan Roy Choudhury. Nilanjan, it's over to you.
Yes, sir. Good evening, esteemed speakers and judges, respected professors and faculty members, and our fellow participants and friends. I am Nilanjan Roy Choudhury from Herombo Chandra Department of Commerce, and today I will be speaking on the topic positive impact of social media on teenagers and college students. Social media has become a part of everyone's life that it cannot be ignored. Social media has many positive impacts not only on youth but also on elders and children. Firstly, a new way of networking. For those students in college or higher education, networking is becoming increasingly important. Thankfully, with social media platforms like LinkedIn, networking can be done from the comfort of our homes. Students are able to take advantage of these platforms to upload their resumes, connect with professionals, and apply for jobs. Social media has transformed the way students think about life after education and finding opportunities for internships and jobs. Secondly, familiarity with technology. Another positive effect of social media on students is its ability to get students, especially young students, familiar with how to use technology. Today, most young people know how to upload a picture, fix minor computer problems, share links, and adjust settings. These things would have seemed impossible for older generations to learn and adapt to at the rapid pace that students are at today. Familiarity with technology also plays a big role in helping students get jobs in tech fields. Last but not the least point is social media as an outlet for creativity. Social media also has a positive effect on students because it provides them an outlet for the creativity. Whether it's posting a short on Instagram, writing poetry on Tumblr, or sharing something they have created on Twitter, social media is the perfect tool for students to showcase their creative work. In fact, there are tons of communities out there where amateur and professional artists alike share their creative work on various social media platforms. Social media is a powerful tool that, when used productively, can have a positive effect on students' education and future. As social networking continues to grow in popularity, it is our premise that technology is a vital part in today's student success. Therefore, social network sites such as Facebook are often conceived of as purely social spaces. However, as these sites have evolved, so have the ways in which students are using them for class organizing behaviors, including self-efficacy and perceived motivation to communicate with others using the site. When placed in the context of social and psychological factors, its positive impact is of high and esteemed value. Thank you. I conclude my speech.
Thank you, Nilanjan. An outstanding performance. Now, we'd like to call upon our next participant, Radha Nari Nandi. Radha.
Okay, I think again we are having some network issues. Please be with us. We will be back shortly. Please have patience. We will be back shortly. We are having some network problem.
Please be with us. We think we have some technical error. So please be with us. Sorry for the inconveniences. We'll be back to you very soon.
We will be back shortly. Sorry for the inconveniences caused. We are having some network issues. Please have patience. Please be with us.
of this topic. So Radha, it's over to you.
Can it be started now, Paromita?
Yes, you are.
Yes, sir, it started. It started.
Okay, okay.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. So good evening, respected dignitaries and my dear friends. Myself, Radharani Nandi of Hiramuchandu College. First of all, I would like to thank all of you for this opportunity. So I will be speaking on the adverse effect of social media on the teenagers and college students. So what is social media? Why is it so important? And finally, what effect can it have on our mental health? Now, a collection of Kenyan universities says that more than 60% of our youth are active on social media. And I'm certain that anything we do for this long or anything we pay this much of attention to has an everlasting effect on us. You see, the problem with excess use of social media is today's youth is tomorrow's future. And we ought to be using internet to build ourselves, to be well equipped with the skills and knowledge as well as strength. But instead, we're using it to destroy ourselves. And the worst part is, we don't even realize. Today, I would like to introduce you to the three stretches that I believe are caused by excess use of social media. Now, these factors are commonly known and faced by almost 100% of all teenagers today. So, let's begin. Now, the first one is insecurity. As I'm sure you know that insecurity is one's lack of confidence in themselves. And now you must be asking yourself that how social media causes insecurity? Well, I will tell you how. Like each and every one of us over here has got a hilaria. Now, social media is your own personal hilaria. You always want to show your wings, your best looks, your amazing holidays, your unforgettable meals. Now, the hilaria is the cause of most teenagers' insecurities today. And that's because we are always comparing our struggle with the other person's hilaria. You look at the picture of your best friend maybe sitting on the beach and you feel, why can't I go on a holiday, or why isn't my skin clear or my body toned? You see, all this insecurity comes from the constant comparison between you and the person you follow. Now, the second stretch is we encounter on going to social media as social currency. Just like currency is something we use to pay tribute to product or service, in social media, the likes, the comments, the shares, this has become a form of social currency, so by which we pay tribute to ourselves. And here, the problem is we are the product. Now, I'm sure that most of us over here in this wave mirror has taken down a post because you did not get as many likes as you thought you would get. And I admit that I have been right there with you all. And I want you to understand that why this is such an epidemic. We tie our self-worth with others going to think of us. We are quantifying it for others to see. And the third step that we encounter in going to social media is FOMO, or the fear of missing out. Now, this is something very normal for us to ignore and make jokes about. What we don't realize is when we do not have access to social media or our phone, this FOMO very quickly turns into a rational withdrawal sometimes. Now that we are aware of some of the negative impact of social media on us, we need to figure out what exactly we're going to do about it. You see, even though social media is way more dangerous, but it can be life-changing in a way as well. We should always remember that our social media experience can be transformed into something healthy, like if we want. Today, I would like to introduce you with this action plan that I believe can transform your social media experience into something that adds value to your life and the people around. So the first step is to build a very strong value system. Now, values describe what is important to you in the way that you live your life. They're the very foundation of your belief, and by nature influences your action, decisions, and behavior. Now, when you begin to take decisions based on your values, you start making very deliberate choices that reflects what is important to us in life. Now, the second step is collaborative creativity. Now, I'm sure we must have some inspiring individuals working tirelessly to start a movement or raising awareness and making a difference. So why not use your time in social media to collaborate with some of these individuals? Now, don't take me wrong. I'm not saying that the only way to use social media in a positive way is by starting a movement or doing something out of the ordinary. I'm absolutely not saying that. Just learning about these movements and educating people around you, making them aware, is a collaboration. There is so much that you as an individual can do to make a difference. The third and the final step is be yourself. If there is nothing that you are planning to take away from this debate today, just remember this simple fact that nobody is me makes me perfect. And never doubt yourself or your self-worth based on the likes you did get or you didn't get over social media. You are perfect. So social media doesn't have to define you or your life. Yes, you are perfect. Thank you.
Well argued back, Radha. Thank you.
We think we have come to an end of the session. And now I would like to hand over this session to our respective judges. Sharon, madam, it's over to you, sir.
Sir and ma'am, I would like to give you 5 minutes, some minutes to discuss about the winner for declaration of results. I would like to give you some minutes for that. And I would like Professor Nirupam Dash and Professor Shatadruti Chakraborty, who are the moderator of this student debate session, if you can sum up the student debate session for 2 days, like yesterday and for today, if you can sum up the debate session. So I would like to give the judges some minutes so that they can decide about the winners of this debate session. So over to Nirupam and Shatadruti. Can we have Shatadruti also? Can we have Shatadruti? Okay, I would like Nirupam to sum up today's session. So when Shatadruti will come, I would request her to do the same.
Thank you, ma'am. Today, we had 4 participants with us. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, you're audible.
So today, we had 4 participants with us. First, starting from Shantani Mondol, and then after that, followed by Soumya Menon and Niranjan Roy Choudhury, and last but not the least, Radharani Nondi. So Shantani Mondol and Niranjan Roy Choudhury, who were in the actually they what they ma'am, am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, very
am
much.
I audible? Okay,
yes,
okay.
Yes, you are audible.
Hmm. Okay. Shantani Mondol and Niranjan Roy Choudhury told us about the positive aspects of this topic, and after that, Soumya Menon and Radharani Nondi they were in the opposition, and they told us about the negative aspect of the topic. So today, our topic was impact of social media on teenagers and college students. So it was a well-executed performance by them. And now I would like to call upon Professor Shatadruti Chakraborty to sum up the session of the first day. So Shatadruti, it's over to you.
Thank you, Professor Nirupam Dash. Yesterday, our topic was COVID-19 is a bigger challenge than... it was unemployment is a bigger challenge than COVID-19. And for the proposition, we had 2 speakers who supported the topic that unemployment is indeed a graver challenge than COVID-19. They presented various statistics and data which showed that how unemployment has grown because of COVID in the last few months through leaps and bounds, and how COVID-19 has actually created this very grave scenario where people have lost their jobs. And I think they have summed up by saying they have supported their proposition and summed up by saying that indeed now livelihoods are at stake. However, we had very 2 strong opponents who were from the opposition, Oyonabho, Noshkar and Sneha Aditya. They felt that unemployment is a lingering problem that has been going on from from the past, and it's not that this problem will be easily solved in the future. So this is a problem which has been in the times of depression, Great Depression. We have faced unemployment during the stock market crashes in the 2008 financial crisis period. Yes, due to COVID, unemployment rate has risen. But to tackle unemployment, we have to tackle COVID first. So COVID is indeed has been a graver issue than unemployment, because unemployment is a problem which has been there before COVID. It will be there in the future. But COVID-19 has to be tackled because people are losing lives. And until and unless we save lives, we cannot go for unemployment, tackling unemployment problem. As Sneha has summed up by saying that only when we can tackle COVID, we can go for this new unlockdown phase, which will again be, which will again create jobs for the economy and unemployment problem will come down. So it was indeed a very enriching discussion, and both the teams were up to the point in supporting their topics, whatever their topics they have prepared through data and statistics. And I would like to conclude this two-day debate session by thanking our judges for their assistance. I heartily thank all the participants for their performances, and I thank the audience for their attentiveness. The debate, we can say, is now concluded.
Thank you, Shatadruti. Thank you, Nirupam. Now I would request our judges to kindly declare the result of students' debate session. May I request our judges to kindly declare the results of the of students' debate session. Over to you, sir and ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Paromita?
Yes, sir.
I am audible. Thank you, Paromita.
Yes.
Now, the topics selected for debate yesterday and today are both relevant in the present scenario. Yesterday, the topic was unemployment and COVID-19. Which one is bigger challenge? It goes without saying that unemployment is one of the biggest problems being faced by the world, including India. But this problem has been compounded by the advent of COVID-19, which has rendered several crores of people jobless, particularly in unorganized sector. India also cannot escape the fury of COVID-19, it has been reported by Center for Monitoring Indian Economy that around 21 million salaried jobs have been lost during last 5 months. Now the challenge posed by COVID-19 can be solved, is expected to be solved sooner than later. All over the world, scientists are trying heart and soul to invent vaccine and drugs. And it is expected that the menace of COVID-19 will be curbed, if not eliminated. But whether we'll be able to solve the unemployment problem, even in remote future, is a matter of question because of some inherent constants existing in the economy. Today, the topic, what is the topic? The topic, social media, impact of social media on the teenager is also time-worthy. And four students debated over this issue that social media has some positive side, need not to be denied. But it can also not be denied that too much use of social media is impacting very adversely the mental health of teenagers. and the social media should be used judiciously. Parents have a great role to play in this regard. Now, all the participants have raised their viewpoints with very conviction, and all the participants are more or less equally well in their performance. But we have to select the best from both the group, and we have to do this thankless job. And I am requesting Professor Lily Law to conclude the session by declaring the best debater. Lily, please.
Yeah. Thank you, Jayanta sir. Am I visible and audible to everyone?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay, so I've been given I wouldn't say it's a thankless job, it's actually a great job to be able to declare the winners of the debate session. And I would like to say that I'm very, I'm very happy and grateful that I've become a part of your debate session in this international webinar. So the result is, as Jayanta has said, all the participants are very close. I mean, it was a difficult decision. It's after some much discussion and deliberation that we have come to the conclusion, since we have to declare single winners. So for day one, that is 19-9-2020, unemployment problem is the bigger challenge than COVID-19. The winner is Sneha Aditya. For day two, where the topic is impact of social media on teenagers and college students, the winner is Shantini Mondol. So the two winners are Sneha Aditya and Shantini Mondol, whom we have selected, as I'm saying, after much discussion and deliberation, for their presentation, their communication, their content, and all other factors that are necessary for a good debate. So I would like to thank everyone present here for inviting me. I had a great time and a lot of intellectual activity too. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. And congratulations to both the winners, Sneha Aditya and Shantini Mondol. Now, as we have come to the last session of two-day international webinar, now I would like to request Dr. Ranjan Addy, Coordinator IQAC Herombo Chandra College, to deliver the vote of thanks. May I have Dr. Ranjan Addy?
Yes. So thank you, Paramita. We have come to the end of the two-day international webinar on Reliant and Emerging India Post-COVID-19. And therefore, it is time to give vote of thanks to all who have made this webinar possible. So before I begin, I would like to beg apology for all the technical snags and problems that have happened and have interrupted the viewing of the participants. Actually, our participants, students, are located in different corners where network is an issue. We know that in different corners of India, network is an issue, and there are some technical problems. So for which our webinar had come to interruptions and in some point of time, but thankfully we have moved on and have come to the conclusion, and it said that all's well that ends well. So we are it is very fortunate that we have come to the end in a very happy note. So now, first of all, I would like to thank our principal, Madam Dr. Navanita Chakraborty, for inspiring us and motivating us to do webinars on very relevant and meaningful topics. And I congratulate the Department of Commerce for choosing this very significant and meaningful topic, Reliant and Emerging India Post-COVID-19. So, in fact, what India will be in future, how far we will be strong, we will be self-reliant, that depends on what we do today, how we respond to this tough and despairing times. So hard times, times of crisis, are a test of character. In sports, we see that the caliber of a sports person is judged not by the statistics, not by the runs he scored or the goals he scored, but how he manages times of crisis, how he takes his team out of despair, out of crisis. Those sportsperson are rated very highly. So similarly, that same theory is applicable to nation, that how we respond to this crisis, to this despairing time, that on that will depend our future. The strength and caliber of a nation is judged by its performance in times of crisis. So Department of Commerce have chosen this topic, and I hope, and I'm very sure also, that our two-day discussion have been very meaningful, and it will surely help us in chalking out our plans, in guiding us towards our goal. Now, I would like to thank the Eastern Regional Council, Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, who have collaborated us, and without whose collaboration this webinar would not have been organized in such a grand and huge scale. So thank you to the council. I also thank to our respected resource person, CA Mr. Nitesh Kumar More, chairman of EIRC ICAI. Thank you, sir, for your valuable time that you have given us and made this webinar more enriching. I would like to thank our resource person of yesterday, Mr. Kaustubh Dasgupta, director and advisory leader, PwC of SDC. Thank you, sir, for your very meaningful participation, for your very enriching and enlightening participation. We hope that you will come to our campus in future for more of guidance. Now, I would also like to thank now to our resource person of today, Mr. Shubhadeep Bandyopadhyay, General Manager of UST Global Austin in Texas. Sir, we are very thankful to you that you have participated and graced the occasion. We are very thankful to you for your enlightening words and the way you also conducted the interactive session. And finally, I also give thanks to Mr. Joydeep Banerjee, General Manager, Budget and Accounts of CESC Kolkata. Mr. Banerjee, we are very thankful to you that you have found out your valuable time and devoted that time to us. And I hope that our students will be very much enriched and inspired by your words. And finally, I thank our beloved teacher, Dr. Shorvishta Banerjee, who is the professor in the Department of Business Management, University of Calcutta. Thank you, ma'am, for your very, very interesting analysis of past and present. That will also guide us, our participants and our students towards forming a better goal for contributing to the making of the reliant and emerging India. So thank you all. Thanks to the organizing committee, the convener, Dr. Paramita Dotto, assistant professor of Hiramuchandra College, and also the entire team of the Department of Commerce, the senior most professor, Dr. Jayanta Ghosh, then Professor Shornishta Dasgupta, the honorable HOD of the department, Dr. Bodhisattva Bardhan Choudhury, who, due to some technical issues, due to some network problems, unfortunately could not join us. Professor Lina Priya De, Professor Aditya Dash, Professor Shatadruti Chakraborty, Professor Nirupam Das, Professor Ishika Ghosh, I thank, not only I should thank, but I congratulate the entire team of commerce for conducting this webinar in such a huge manner and in a very, I would say, in a very successful way, because success depends upon not only the technical thing, but on the content. The content was very great. And I congratulate the therefore the team of the Department of Commerce, and the Department of Commerce I am proud to say is the biggest, the largest in our college. 90% of our students belong to this department. So at present there are more or less from 2,500 and above, or around 2,500 students who belong to the Department of Commerce. And in fact, the Department of Commerce have arranged this webinar in the most grand manner, where we have had a galaxy of resource persons. So they have arranged the largest galaxy, the largest team of resource persons. So I congratulate the organizers from the bottom of my heart. And last but not the least, I would like to thank our students. I was talking about the technical problems, but out of the end, but just before, out of the end of darkness, there is a silver lining. So after the technical problems, there was this participant, Radharani, who spoke of collaborative creativeness, who spoke of value system, of strengthening our value system. So I congratulate Radharani. I congratulate all my students, all our students, for their very smart and intelligent participation, the way they have held on, their commitment, their patience, that shows that that our future is not dark. So we come to the end of the session, and finally, I also thank my senior in my department, Dr. Lily Law, for adjudging the participants in the debate and declaring the prize. Thank you, Lily ma'am, once again, and thank you to all the people whom I may have forgotten, which I failed to mention, but who have contributed. For also, I would like to thank Dr. Sheikh Abul Salam, librarian of Shibpur Dinobondhu Institution, without whose help we would not have been able to organize this seminar in this platform. So I thank him from the bottom of my heart. We are also very grateful to these platforms, digital platforms such as StreamYard and YouTube. So they have bridged the gap between students and teachers. So in this time, we are very anxious to reach to our students. We feel, if a teacher cannot reach his student, he feels almost an existential crisis. So in this time, it is these digital platforms who have actually salvaged not only the students, but salvaged also us. So we are also very grateful to them, and we are stepped into this digital path. India has stepped into this digital path, and there is no going back now. So in future, we only have to ensure that all our students can have access to network, can have access to devices with which they can access to digital content, not only digital lectures, but digital contents. So we know that any researcher nowadays cannot perform his research without access to digital world. So we have stepped into this world. This COVID time has been a very decisive time also. So it has guided India into this digital path in a very decisive manner, and there is no returning back. So thank you, all of us. So with this, I thank all our participants also that they have viewed our program patiently, and appreciated us and criticized us. We thank all and all who have participated in the interactive session. So now I declare our two-day webinar to a conclusion, to an end. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.